this morning we learned, hopefully, how to write functional equations for the enumeration of planar maps. And so I write again two of the equations that we obtained. So the first one was for a series called M of Tn y, which counts all maps M by the edge number and the outer degree, which is the degree of the outer face. And so there were several others, but I'll give the one we got for triangulations of a polygon, say, which was, so that was our second series. Oops, sorry. So the sum over all triangulation of polygon of, well, the same two parameters, the edge number and the degree of the outer face. And so the first one read like this. So I recall that I usually drop the dependence in T. So that's one for the atomic map. Then comes the bridge case. And then the non-bridge case, which involves one of these divided differences, which I sometimes call discrete derivatives. And for the polygon case, instead of having this divided difference near 1, we had it near 0. So there was a slightly different initial condition, maps reduced to one edge, one bridge, and then there was a quadratic term, which must be this one. And then I should adjust this. Then comes the divided difference. So here, P1 is the coefficient of y in P of y. So that's the generating function of triangulations of a polygon reduced to a loop. So maybe we can draw, if I can. So this, for instance, is counted in the series P1. Okay, so that's our two specimens, and they have a lot in common. As I say, they are quadratic, and they involve a specialization of the series in this case. This can be seen as well as a specialization of the first derivative in y evaluated when y is zero. So these two things are rather analogous. And so we could live happily with that, but in fact we're going to solve them. And to prove that not only you have equations of this type, but in fact you have algebraic solutions. And so one of our claims, or one of our theorems in fact, will be that M, so now I restore the dependence in T, sorry, and the counterpart for triangulations of a polygon are both algebraic. Over Q of Ty, the field of rational functions in T and Y. So this means that, say, for M, you will have a polynomial okay. So you could say, well, this is an equation of this type. If only there was no m of 1 here, we would have a polynomial equation for m of ty, but there is m of 1. Okay, and so what I want to do is to tell you at the moment not a theorem, but a recipe to get from these equations, and more generally for one of these polynomial equations with one catalytic variable, to an algebraic equation, say, for this series or for that series. And it's quite clear that once you've proved that M of 1 is algebraic, then this M of Y is quadratic over the field generated by T, Y, and M of 1. So it will be a further algebraic extension, and it will be algebraic as well. So really, the key point is proving the algebraicity of these two things. And in fact, we are very much interested in so M of 1. That's really the series we wanted to obtain, the generating function of planar maps counted by edges only. And we can decide, so P1, well, that's the generating function of triangulations of this loop, T to the edge number. Okay, so here's the recipe. So that's what you should try. And why it works, I think I will not explain. But in a sense, if you have your equation, well, you want it to work. You don't necessarily want to know why it works. Well, that's a bad mathematical behavior. But, but it's much more complicated to design a framework where you can prove that this will systematically work. We've done that, but I don't want to explain this part of our results. So by the way, so this is something that we did some years ago with Arnaud Jehan, and the paper, I think, appeared in 2006. So the recipe tells you that you should look for series, and here I'm being a bit vague. I'm not saying at the moment whether it should be a power series or a series maybe with fractional powers of t, maybe with a few negative powers of t. We'll drop that for the moment. And after all, it's a recipe, so it can be a bit vague. You know, you add a bit of this and a bit of that, and recipes are not precise. So for a series y, which depends on t, but not on y, such that I should tell you what we are starting from. We start where I ended my previous lecture, from a polynomial equation that relates some m. Maybe I should give it a different name so that you don't think it's necessarily this M, so let's call it G, like a generating function. Then you have a bunch of K series that depend on T only. So there's only series that depend on Y. So you start from this equation. So certainly these two things are of this type, where k is 1. There's only one of these auxiliary series, this one, that one, and g is m and p. Okay? So you start from that, and so this polynomial is a polynomial in k plus three variables, which I will denote x0, x1, xk, and then t and y. Yes. Otherwise, you know what you have. And this is indeed the case here. If m of 1 was known, I would be done. And I want to determine m of 1 from this. You mean? No, here I don't know either. Yep, yep. Well, if A1, AK, the only thing I can tell is that G of Y is algebraic over the field of fractions generated by these things. There was another question, yeah? Yeah, so at the moment, I have not said anything like that. I'm just giving a recipe. In many occasions, it will not apply. I mean, if I give you G of Y is A1 squared, that's one of these equations. Certainly, there are solutions which are transcendental, not algebraic. This equation has infinitely many solutions. So for the recipe to work, I mean, any A1 that I take, any series here, defines a G, and they have no reasons of being algebraic. So the recipe will only work on some well-founded equations. And what is essentially required for an equation to be well-founded is that you have a unique k plus 1 tuple of power series in T that are solutions. And sometimes you should, in addition, insist that this one has, as when expanded in powers of T, has polynomial coefficients in Y. So definitely the recipe will not work for an arbitrary equation, but for well-founded equations with a combinatorial origin, as the ones we wrote, it will work. And we'll apply the few steps of this recipe to the equation for M or P. But there's indeed something a bit surprising here. So there is a theorem. So there is a form of polynomial for which I can prove, a rather general form, that indeed this works. And now I have to tell you what I mean by this. So, a Y such that if you take the derivative of this polynomial with respect to its first variable, so that's the one which stands for the main unknown bivariate series, and so you want to evaluate it at the point G of big Y, and then you have your series in T and T and the big Y. Okay, so let's implement this, say, for the first equation, okay, which you have here on the left. So when I say polynomial, it could be also a rational function. It makes no difference. And of course, each time you have a rational function of this type, you also have a polynomial one. So here, in the M case, what I called, was in fact a rational function. I had one auxiliary series. And so this is, so I want to write it pole equals zero. So it's minus x0 plus 1 plus ty squared. And then there's ty. Y x naught minus x 1 over y minus 1. Okay, so let's apply the recipe. I look at the derivative of this thing with respect to its first variable, which occurs here, here, and here. Okay, so it's a polynomial of degree 2 in x naught. So I wonder whether there exists a y, which should depend on t, such that, so there is a minus 1. Here I have this quadratic term, so 2t big y squared, and then m of y. Because remember, so I evaluate this first derivative at my usual point. And then here I have plus t y squared over y minus 1. And this should be equal to 0. Okay, so I want to multiply out by y minus 1. And I take y out. I shouldn't try to do this too quickly, otherwise. Okay, so that's the equation that this y, I tell I'm looking for, should satisfy. It's not equal to 0. That's a bit too demanding. Thank you. Okay, so I should stop at this point saying I don't want at this stage to determine why. I just want to know if such series exist and how many exist. Given that this M, which I don't know, unfortunately, that's what I'm after at the moment, knowing that this M is the generating function of maps counted by edges and outer degree. So what do you think? Does there exist such a series? Why? Exactly. So that's an argument that we had somehow this morning. If I look for a power series in T satisfying this, well, given that I have here a factor T and here there, I know that it's so y is the sum of y n tn. I know that the constant term should be 1. And now, knowing that, well, of course I don't know m, but still it's a well-defined series, which means that I can characterize the coefficients here, one after the other, in terms of the series M, which I don't know. So what this is telling you is that there is a unique power series in T that solves this. Okay. Wow. What is this good for? Yeah? Yeah, so it's not exactly the Lagrange inversion, but it's close to that. And certainly you could write, you could probably write something. But at the moment, I just want to be convinced that there is one, and in fact only one, series satisfying this. Okay, so what should we do with it? Well, we go back to our original equation, which holds now for y for variable 1, for an indeterminate y. And what I'm going to do is to differentiate it with respect to y. Okay, so I have y here and y there. So let's do that. So we have So now this is for small y. And then comes the derivative of g with respect to y. So I've taken care of this place, and now there's this one. Always at the same point. Okay? You agree with that? That's the usual chain rule or whatever it's called for differentiating a function. So this is always true. So in particular, maybe I should insist here that given that y is a series in T, my m of y, which is really m of t and of y of t, is well defined. And that's certainly something important. So this m itself was a power series in t with polynomial coefficients in y. And then when you replace y by a series in t, it's a well-defined power series. But if I had found a y, I don't know, starting with 1 over t, or I could have been in trouble, and the substitution possibly would not have been legal. Okay, so now, having this general equation, I replace my little y, I specialize it to this y that cancels this first derivative. So this now becomes 0. And so from that, I'm learning that this thing as well. So now specialized at this series y now I started from this equation, some derivative vanishes, and I got that, also the last, somehow, derivative of P0 vanishes. So let's get back to our example. So this was my first equation, which I had convinced myself had a unique power series solution. And then I get that the derivative with respect to y is also 0. I'm going to make mistakes. So y is here and here everywhere. So this is telling me that 2ty m of y squared. Okay, I won't compute this derivative. I'm lazy. So I have here a rational function. No, I should do it. I shouldn't be lazy, but I'm going to do mistakes. Okay, so how do you differentiate this with respect to y? So so that's 2y m of y minus m of 1, so that's my x1. And then minus t y m of y minus m of 1 over y minus 1 squared. Hopefully. So what I've done is I've differentiated this with respect to little y and specialized when little y is big y. X naught is m of y and x1 is my auxiliary series m of 1. Yes? Sorry? So, so ah, yes, here, okay, thank you. Yeah, that was it. Okay, so for this y, which I know exists, there is this second equation. This is equal to zero. You're always complaining. When I write it, you don't want it, and when I don't want it. Okay. Okay. And then, of course, I have the third equation, which is always true for any y, and then should be true also for this big Y. Can you read here? Yeah? Also on the first row? Why? Why can you? It's okay? Okay, if you say so. I go on. And so here we have the original equation, m of y is 1 plus t y squared m squared plus t y. Okay. And so now I claim that we can actually do something for this M case. So we have written three equations. So we have three polynomial equations that relate how many series? What are the unknown series in this set of three equations? I'm asking you. Yeah. So we have this y that we know exists, but it's the only thing we know. There's the value that our series takes at y. And then there's an auxiliary series, A1 or M of 1. So it seems that we are in a good shape. After all, we have three equations now that relate three unknown series. So if things work nicely, these three polynomial or rational equations, they form a system of dimension zero, that is, they are not redundant. And so maybe you'll be able to perform elimination in this system to get, in particular, an equation for this series. And this will be an algebraic equation for this series. And this turned out to be the case, so let's call them 1, 2, and 3. And so using, for instance, resultants and your favorite computer algebra system, mine is Maple, you can eliminate, say, for instance, y and m of y from the system 1, 2, and 3. And this gives some other polynomial, so I write it that way, in T, and M of 1 is 0. Okay. Three polynomial equations with three unknowns, and what happens is what you would hope for. So either today or the next time, I'll show you a Maple session where these kind of computations are performed. And you'll see it works nicely. So what happens here is that in this case, when you do that, you get a polynomial, so which must be satisfied by your series M of 1, and that has several factors. And you need to decide which of these factors is cancelled by M of 1. But you know the first terms of M of 1, so that's the generating function of maps. So maybe I should have told you from the beginning how it starts. So that's M of T and 1. So we had, as I said, the atomic map. So that's a 1. And then you have two maps with a single edge. Oops. So that's a 2T, and so on and so forth. So knowing a few of the first terms of your series M of 1, you can decide among the several factors of this final polynomial which is the one that is cancelled by your series. And this works nicely, and you obtain four maps, so a quadratic equation. Write it down. I don't know it by heart. So the right factor is 27t squared times f m of 1 squared plus 1 minus 18t m of 1 plus 16t minus 1 is 0, which you then solve, and you obtain that the edge generating function of planar maps has a very nice algebraic expression. So that's the sum over all maps of C to the edge number. And if you know how to expand 1 plus x to some power alpha, you'll get that this is the sum of 2 times 3 to the n divided by n plus 1, n plus 2. Okay, so what did we do? We started from our first map equation. We've applied our recipe, which happened to work nicely. We've obtained, in this case, a quadratic equation for these specialized series M of 1, which we could solve easily. And in this case, we even got a nice expression for the coefficients. Yeah? Okay, so we'll come to that, yeah? So what should I do? Should I come to the generic case or try to apply the same recipe to polygons? Sorry? Polygons. Okay, so let's do it for polygons. So what should I erase? Probably this thing here. So in principle, of course, it could happen, but so I can give two kinds of optimistic answers to that. So first, for a certain proper form, whatever this means, of the equation you started from, you will get something of dimension zero, and then some more experimental well, at the end I will have a theorem that, well, that tells you at least that the thing is algebraic. It won't tell why this method works, but it will tell you about the algebraicity. Are there more questions? No? Okay, so let's move to the PKs. Triangulations or a polygon. Okay, so the equation y, so maybe I should write what pull is. So again, we have just one of these auxiliary series. So what is it equal to? So we have minus x naught plus t y squared plus t over y. That's even simpler than it was before. We have x naught minus y x1. Okay. Okay, so does there exist a y satisfying this, which should read minus y? I'm missing something here. It's, no, I forgot the quadratic. Sorry, I should write it in the right order. I forgot the quadratic case, which was t over y x naught squared plus t over y x naught minus y x1. That's better. Okay, so the first derivative, that is the derivative with respect to x naught, should vanish. So this is telling me, so x naught is now p of my big Y, and this is also a big Y. And here I have a t of y, and this should be zero. Okay, so I multiply out by y, and this should give me t plus 2t p of y. Oh, that's even nicer. I should have started with this one. Okay, so of course we do not know the series P, but it's a series in T with the polynomial coefficients in Y. And so we can wonder, do you think there exists a power series Y satisfying this? Sorry? Yeah, that's a fair answer. But in this case as well, so there's Lagrange, indeed. And but in this case as well, you see that, well, first, there cannot be any constant term in y, because here everything is a multiple of t. And then the coefficient of t to the 1, given that p starts with one edge, okay, so this is big O of t squared, whatever you do. So the first coefficient, that is the coefficient of t to the 1, should be 1. And then again, because of this factor t, if you know the first n minus 1 coefficients, then the next one is determined in terms of the coefficients of p. So yes, there is a power series solution of that, and in fact a unique one. Okay, so then the recipe tells us that another derivative vanishes, namely the derivative with respect to the y here. So our second equation will read 2ty minus t over y squared p of y squared plus, or rather minus, t over y squared And here I have P of y. And this term here is independent of y. Okay, so that's equation number two. And as before, we shouldn't forget that we have the original equation, which being valid for any y is also valid for that y, and which is the one we have here, minus p of y, also p of y, is t y squared, plus t over y, p of y squared, plus t, p of y, minus y, p1, over y. Okay, so it's again the same story. We have, say, forced one equation, the first one, derived from this first derivative vanishing consequence, and then we put this together with the original equation. And again, so I could replace here m by p, m of 1 by the series p1. And here we get a polynomial for this p1, which I can maybe find in my notes. Yes. So this P1, which is a series in T, counting triangulations of a one gun, satisfies now a cubic equation, which I can write just to show you that it exists. Cubed minus 1 p1 squared. Okay, so a cubic equation. There's something else that you can observe here, which is that you have some kind of periodicity in the variable t, and this comes from the fact that in a triangulation of a one gun, you always have a number of edges that's 2 mod 3. And this can be seen using your Euler's relation, for instance. Okay, then about, so this is a cubic, you can of course solve it with the radicals, but that's not something you'd like to see. And this series also has some nice coefficients, but at the moment, so that's something I'm going to discuss next time. Did I write them somewhere? Doesn't seem like it. So I'll spend a bit of time next time, probably, discussing how you can extract nice coefficients from that using some modern or not so modern tools. Okay, now let me insist, once we have found an algebraic equation for P1 over the field of fractions in T, then we can, say by eliminating P1, get an algebraic equation for P of y. So indeed, that was my claim, these series are algebraic. Okay, so now let me tell you what happens in the what we should expect if things work nicely when you have k of this series, of this auxiliary series. So I'm getting back to this framework. So, well, clearly, if we determine one such series here cancelling this, well, we'll certainly get gain three equations, but they will involve y, g of y, and then all the ai's. And so three equations in k plus two unknowns. There's no hope this will be sufficient. So what happens, and what you should hope for, is that you find, so that this problem admits k series solution. Y1 up to yk. If this is the case, and again, you will, from the form, as we did here, from the form of this equation number one, you'll be able to tell that there are k series, or three, or two, or 10. Then for each of them, so you have the first equation, should I write this again? Yeah. So now with for every I between 1 and k, you have the three equations. The first derivative vanishes. The last derivative vanishes, and the original equation also holds. So that's now a system. And this is valid for every I. So for each of these solutions here. So what remains to do is to count how many equations and unknown series we have in this system. So how many equations? 3k equation, okay? For each I, we have three equations. So we have 3k polynomial equations. How many unknown series do we have in this system? So which are the unknown series? Okay, so there's k of them. Then there's the g of yi. There's also k. And then, okay, yeah. Yeah. So I take the polynomial itself, written as a polynomial in x0, x1, xk, t, and y. Do I still have an example?
Now y is yi.
So I started from a polynomial in many variables. Okay, so that's an abstract object. And when I talk of its last derivative, I talk of this polynomial, which I evaluate at this point. So maybe I should have called it dk plus 3 because it's the derivative with respect to the k plus third variable. But indeed, this is just the original variable and has nothing to do with the big y's. Now there are several of them. Are there more questions? Okay, so, and what I claim is that in the instances that you will meet from combinatorics, and in fact for some proper equations of this type, you will indeed find k solutions of this such that g of yi is well defined, because this is always a condition that we need. And that in addition, this system will have dimension zero, and that you will be able, from this system of 3k equations, to, say, eliminate the yi's and the g of yi's, and say any of the k minus 1 of these ai series to obtain for each of them that a certain polynomial in T and AI is zero. So that each of the auxiliary series that you had in your original equation is algebraic, which then implies, using the first equation, that G of Y is algebraic over G of T and Y. So now, I haven't prepared an example with several auxiliary series, but maybe I should be adventurous and try to write one for you, because I want to explain how you decide how many equations you have here. So maybe I could write something for maps, an equation for maps with faces of degree 2 and 3. This will not suffice. I should go 2, 3, and 4 to have 2. You confirm this? Okay, let's try to do something that may fail. That is one more example. Yeah? Yes, you are very right. That's a good observation, and indeed, so this is not a theoretical problem, but it will be a problem when you want to implement this. After all, I mean, you've written k times that these three equations have a solution. So you've written k times the same three equations, replacing y1 by y2. So what? So the point is that you should add to the existence of this system that it has k, in fact, distinct solutions. And this is real information. Otherwise, saying that this has solutions is just saying that this holds for y1. I mean, this is just having three equations. So that's an important point. And so, for instance, if you want to perform elimination in this system using Grubner bases or whatnot, you should at some point inject some additional conditions saying that yi is different from yj, which in some Grubner bases calculation you can prescribe by saying, by adding new variables, say uij, and adding that yy minus yj times uij should be 1, which prevents this to be 0, from being 0. So that's an important observation. Yeah, thank you. Yeah? Very often they do. And so, for instance, in the map case, they have nice, this series Y has a nice coefficients. And in fact, for reasons that I do not understand, very often, so you end with some algebraic equation, algebraic curve here. And in many cases, the genus of this curve is zero. Namely, it has a rational parameterization. And what is observed is that you can take for this rational parameterization the series Y. And what I mean by that is that the parameterization of your final curve is writing that T, sorry, no. So very often, what happens for this Y is that you can express T as a rational function of Y. That is, yeah, so this is one way of writing the algebraic equation satisfied by Y. So here, for instance, you don't have, so here you would have, I guess, T3 or something like that. So in many cases, we can understand this series as the generating function of some trees, typically. And then you have these bijective approaches that indeed relate your maps to that family of trees. But why this series of trees should come out of this recipe, that's not clear to me. But yes, they are often nice, this series. Okay, so what I will do now is dive in the unknown and try to show you one example with several of these series AI. And this, I think, should be found when you count maps with finite faces of degree 3 or 4. So I call G the generating function. Shortcut is G of Y. And so for these maps, I will do the same exercise as this morning. I will take out the root edge and look at what's left. So let's do it. So there's the atomic map. Then there's the bridge case. And then there's the bean case, where when I delete the root edge, I get here, so I have here a face of degree 3 and 4, and when I delete the edge, I get something that's connected. So it's always the same good old story. So here, this is always this term, ty squared, g of y squared. And here comes this condition. So if I call M prime the small bean-shaped map, and it came by deletion of the root edge of a map with degrees 3 and 4. So this means that my map M prime had outer degree not too small. this is m prime. So the outer degree of m prime. So here I had either a triangle like this or a quadrangle like that. So if I have a triangle, this means that the outer degree was at least 2. And if I want to build a quadrangle, I need to have outer degree at least 3. So if you chew a bit what we did this morning, I'll try. So say we want to create a triangle, so we should take all maps, but not the empty one. Not the one that have outer face 1. We add an edge. And so if we create a triangle, the outer degree decreases by 1. This is creating a triangle. And if we want to create a quadrangle, we should start from something that has outer degree at least 2, at least 3, sorry. And we decrease by 2 the outer degree. So even if you don't follow the details, I hope that you're understanding the music of that. I mean, we're creating this new face, and this only works if we have sufficiently many edges, or corners, rather, in the outer face. So I just wanted to give you one example where we really have 2 of these auxiliary series, A1 and A2, which are here, G1 and G2. And so what I want to do now is to look at this equation or that problem and to try to convince ourselves that indeed we find 2 solutions of that, hopefully. So where should I do that? Maybe here. Okay, so I want to write equation 1 for this problem. So what is my polynomial in x0, x1, x2, ty? So I have minus the main series g, and then plus 1 plus ty squared, x0 squared, plus t x naught minus 1 minus y x 1 minus y squared. No, here I had just this one. And then the case of a quadrangular face. Okay, that's my polynomial, which is in fact a rational function. Okay, and I want to look at this first equation, what I impose on my series y. So this thing here, how does it read in this case? So I have minus 1 coming from here, plus t, 2t, y squared, and there's g of y. That's this term. Then I have minus t over y squared times x naught minus 1, so that's g of y minus 1. So that's this term. And then here, what do I have? Minus 2t. So I take this g of y minus 1 over y cubed. And then I have one more term, which will give a plus t over y squared. And then this auxiliary series, which was t1. The x naught, so I'm writing this equation. No, you're right, I'm not doing what I'm... This is much simpler, thank you. Yeah, so that's much simpler, so it's t over y plus t over y squared. Thank you. Much nicer. Okay, so the y's I'm looking for, they should satisfy this. Y squared should be 1. No, sorry, should be t plus ty plus 2t y to the fourth t of y. And that's the equation which I called the first equation. So are there formal power series in T satisfying that? Watch out. I know what your answer will be. I'm asking about formal power series in T. Can we find one that will satisfy this? Yeah, okay. So that's it. So formal power series in T, we won't find any. So its constant term should be 0 because of these T's. But then what should be the coefficient of T to the 1? Well, y2 will start with some t squared, and so this will be of a much higher valuation. This will be at least t cubed, and something that is t squared cannot be equal to something that's equal to t, so there's no power series, even with the Lagrange inversion. So there's no power series solution of that. But as Philippe said, there are power series in square root t. So indeed, if we write, say, t is equal to s squared, so then the equation looks like this, s squared plus 1. And so you expect to find a solution starting with a term, so no constant term, and then plus s, and then another solution with minus s. And indeed, this will be the case. I mean, you have a general theorem telling you how many power series you should expect from this. And so you have indeed two roots, say y1 and y2. So if you want, that's a version of Newton's polygon method that tell you that indeed such series exists. And then I've not done it, but I did it for a more general case, but you can prove that then your three key equations, here you'll get six equations, they adding in addition that y1 and y2 are not zero, you define a system that has dimension zero. Okay, so that's the recipe. And now there's two things that I'd like to do. Yeah? No, there's some examples where you have one of the roots that has constant term zero and the other has constant term one. And so they branch from the first term and you don't need to introduce fractional powers of t. And there's also cases where you get, in fact, more than k solutions. I've seen that, but somehow, yeah, so this may happen. But I've not seen, fortunately, any example where you would get fewer than k solutions. Or else it means that there was some relations that you missed between your unknown series. There may be, but the quick answer is not that I know. But I mean, among the two things I want to tell in the rest of the lecture, there's one which tells you that this is an instance of something that has very deep roots of a strong theorem in Artin's approximation theory. And certainly these people have a completely different understanding of my little recipe. Yeah? You could decide that indeed you are counting maps by the number of half edges, even though this is a bit artificial. But since I don't have any combinatorial understanding of these two series, Y1 and Y2, I'm not relating them directly to something combinatorial. Or I'm not relating their coefficients to something combinatorial. Okay, so the two things I want to do, one is I want to relate this recipe to what is known as the quadratic method, and that maybe a number of you already know. So if you look at this book by Golden and Jackson that I mentioned this morning, they look at some basic map counting problems and they solve the corresponding equations, which are the ones that I wrote here. They solve it by the so-called quadratic method. And I want to tell you what it is and why it is the same thing as this, except that this doesn't require the equation to be quadratic. And then the other thing I want to tell you about is this theorem, general theorem, which I learned from some algebraists, and which is called sum Artin approximation theorem, and which implies algebraicity without giving you the recipe to follow to obtain an explicit algebraic equation. And that's something I learned just by chance a year and a half ago, because there was some guy who was invited in Marseille at CIRM, Herwig Hauser, who had understood that these approximation theorems that he's familiar with were related to this kind of equations that occur in several combinatorial problems. So here I'm telling you about map equations, but there are several equations for counting walks, lattice walks confined in a cone that are very similar to that. And so that's how he got interested in those equations. And so he had a more algebraic point of view, and that's thanks to him that I learned this connection. Should I erase? Okay, so I forgot to give a title to this lecture, so it was called Lecture 2, and its title was, sorry, I'm a bit out of my mind, was Polynomial Equations with One Catalytic Variable. That was part one, the recipe with examples, and then suddenly comes a part two, which is the so-called quadratic method. Okay, so this applies to the case where your polynomial equation so at least as described in Gulden and Jackson, you need to have, that's another restriction, you need to have only one of these auxiliary series, which as we've seen is sometimes the case. And not only you want k to be 1, but you want the equation to be quadratic in x naught. So let's call it, we have a coefficient in x1, t, y, then we have x naught squared plus b times x naught. Plus some c of the remaining variables. So this is the form of our polynomial. So I'll tell you what this quadratic method, which was designed by Brown, who was a student of Tert, and some people say that it was in fact Tert's ideas, but this you can find in a paper of Brown in the 60s. And the title is something like on power series which have a square root, something not so intuitive. Okay, so now starting from this, so I could try to solve it by forming a square in x naught. So you get something like 2a. And now I should replace this by my real values. Sorry. So this up to some factor is proportional to 2a x1 t y x naught plus b squared minus the discriminant, which is b carré moins 4ac, b squared minus plus 4ac. So in other words, your equation reads 2a of a1 t y times c of y plus some b of a1 t y is equal to some discriminant, which is a polynomial in a1 t and y. And I forgot the square, which is embarrassing. Okay, so that's a generic way of writing a polynomial that's quadratic in g of y. Okay. So if I were to solve this, I would take the square root of the discriminant and take the b. So what is this quadratic method saying for such equations? It tells if there exists, it starts a bit in the same way, y, it should depend on t, such that this term in the brackets vanishes. So this discriminant, that's b squared minus ac, so it's a polynomial in a1, t, and y. So certainly, if y cancels the left-hand side, should also cancel the right-hand side. But since it is here a double root of the left-hand side, it should also be a double root of the right-hand side. You can see this if you want. You differentiate this with respect to y. Here you will get something times another factor, 2ag plus b, which will be zero by assumption. And here you get the derivative of delta. So any y satisfying this, I go on here, then y is a double root of delta seen as a polynomial in y. That is delta of a1 t big y is zero, and so is the derivative of this polynomial. So I like to summarize this as follows. So this delta, it was the discriminant of this quadratic equation seen as an equation in G, G of Y. And this discriminant is a polynomial involving A1, T, and Y. What I'm saying is that as a polynomial in Y, it has a double root. So its own discriminant with respect to Y is zero. So we've taken some iterated discriminant of a polynomial equation where we've just taken the discriminant with respect to x naught. Then with respect to y, this leaves us with a polynomial in t and the x1, which is the auxiliary series, and this should be zero. So that's, I say that the discriminant of the discriminant vanishes. And in fact, even though that's not obvious to see, this is also what will happen here in the general framework. So you don't have, in this case, an explicit expression of the discriminant in terms of your series. But still, each of these yi's will be a double root of the discriminant. But that's harder to prove in this case. OK, and so this gives you, by eliminating y, a polynomial equation for a1. And that's the quadratic method. So now I want to tell you that if we apply this general recipe on that quadratic equation, we are just writing the same two equations. So let's do that. So I start from this. So say I take this as my polynomial in x0, x1, 1 ty. So that was a proportionality, not an alpha. And I denote this delta of x1 ty. And I apply this recipe here. Okay. So what is this equation, the derivative of this quadratic with respect to x naught? Yes, they should be. So that is, if you write this, expand this square, you should get this. No, there's something. Yeah, you should get this equation multiplied by A, I think. So this is indeed the same. Okay, so what? How does this equation read for this equation here, for this specific value of pole? So maybe I'll write it again. So that's pole x naught x1 ty is equal to 2a of whatever x, no, it shouldn't be whatever. X1 ty x naught plus b of the same three guys minus delta of the same three guys, which are x1, t, and y. Okay, so what is the first derivative? Shouldn't be too hard. What happens when you differentiate this with respect to x naught? Hey. Differentiate a quadratic. Nobody wants to answer. It's too easy. You feel offended by my questions? So writing that this is zero is writing that 2a of a1 ty g of y plus b of a1 ty equals zero. Okay, so this is writing that the thing that we take the square of vanishes. Oh. Look at that. This was exactly what Brown suggested to look at. It's the same equation. Okay, cancel the thing between brackets. Okay, so we'll get the same series. And now what will we say? That if this vanishes, so this was our equation number one, now we move to equation number two. What is it saying? That then the derivative of this polynomial with respect to y is also zero. Okay, so let's differentiate this with respect to y. We have a 2, then we have 2a g of y plus b times something, which I don't want to write, but we are differentiating a square here, minus, take the derivative with respect to y, is equal to zero. Okay, so that's equation number two. And equation number three is just the original equation, which tells you that 2a times g of y plus b squared is equal to delta. So these are the three equations that our recipe gives. And over there, you have the two equations, only two, that Brown's approach gives. I tell you that delta is zero and its derivative is also zero. But that's an immediate consequence of this, because here we've said that 2ag plus b is zero. So in fact, our second equation just reads delta prime is equal to zero, and the third one just is that delta admits y as a root. So really, the two consequences of the quadratic method are just equations 2 and 3 in our recipe. So that's really the same thing. We're looking at the same series y, and we're writing the same properties for them. Okay, and I will finish with this thing that I learned, as I said, recently. Are there questions on this part? Okay, so let's say that's a third part, which is a general algebraicity theorem. So here's this theorem. And it's a special case of a theorem due to Popescu in 86. So there were complaints, as I understand, about his proof, but then there has been given other proofs that supposedly are more convincing. And so his theorem deals with power series in an arbitrary number of variables. I'm just going to state it with two variables, t and y. And then there's another more general property in his theorem, which then justifies the idea that it is some Artin approximation theorem. You won't see any approximation here, but I can tell you later where the approximation is hiding in the more general statement. So this will apply, the way I write it, it will apply to systems of polynomial equation with one catalytic variable. And under some assumptions, we will have, it will conclude that the solution, and in fact all pieces of the solutions, are algebraic. Okay, so how should I write this? So you consider a system of polynomial equation so you have say n equations, pi, which involve n series g1, gn. Formerly, we had just one of them. Then maybe k series a. So that's for 1 less than I less than n. And you assume that this system has a unique solution. And we want again to say that these things depend on t only, and this one's on t and y. And the solution should be unique in psi series, in t and y for the g's. So you have n of them, and then series in t for the other k. So we'll get back to an example later, and this example will be, say, the equation for planar maps. So that's an important condition. You require uniqueness of the solution and the fact that these K series depend on T only. And then the conclusion is what you guess. That is then the GIs and AIs are algebraic. So respectively over C of YT and C of T for the AIs. I have one A parenthesis. So that's not a proof that I've read, and it seems a rather scary thing. I don't know how constructive it is. Maybe there's something like my recipe hidden in there. I don't know. But at least if you have a system of these equations and you are able to check uniqueness of the condition, then you can say, oh, my series are algebraic. So it's, yes, you're right. So these are the two indeterminates, and you're looking at this system as a system in n plus k unknowns, and you prescribe that they are series in T and Y for the GIs, and in T only for the As. So let's see how we can apply this to prove that the generating function of triangulations of a polygon is algebraic. So what did we have? We had P of Y, was T Y squared plus T over Y, P of Y squared plus T P of Y minus 1 p1 over y. That was our equation. So we have just one equation. So n is 1. So I will have a system reduced to a single equation, p. Oh, sorry, that's a bad choice, p. How should I call it? Q. So here I consider the equation Q of G A T Y equals 0. This will be my system, where Q, and this is equal to minus G plus T Y squared. So I should probably multiply out by T, which I'm going to do later. Sorry, by y. So really what I want to do is to have something really polynomial that's important. So I multiply out by y. I know you shouldn't do that at the blackboard if people want to take notes. Sorry. Okay, so here's one small system in two unknowns, G and A. Could it be that it has a unique power series, a unique solution in C or Q in our case? In which case, we would know that this, well, we do know one solution, which is G equals to P of Y and A equals to P1 is a solution. If we can prove that there's a unique solution of this type, then we know that this unique solution is algebraic, which means that our generating function is algebraic without giving its value. So the only point we have to check is this one. Okay, so imagine we have a solution, say G, and now I will insist on the dependence and write it G of T and Y and A, which is a series in Y only, that solves this. Yeah, you have a question? Yeah. Y equals zero. Yeah, exactly. Okay, yeah. Yeah.
So how do we capture this?
So we'll precisely see now where we capture it, again by specialization. So assume you have a pair GA that cancels this polynomial equation, then if you specialize so what should you do? So I had prepared it with M, and so now I switch to P in the hope it will work as well. I'm a bit puzzled. So you can certainly, let's see if it works like that. You can certainly specialize y to zero, okay? So specializing a bivariate series in t and y to y equal to zero is something well defined. So this equation should hold when y is zero. And so it should tell you that t g of t and 0 squared plus t g of t and 0. I should have stick to my original example. okay, equals 0. Now what? So I have this t g factor. I can simplify by T, certainly. Can I simplify? I would like to... Yes, and I would like to exclude one. So you have either g of t not equal zero or g of t not is equal to minus one. So should I give one more? I'm sorry, I should have stick to my original example. So maybe I should give one more condition here. Of course, that's the one that we want. Oh, you're telling me, yeah, so you're right. I should also specialize t to zero to decide between these two possible values. So when t is zero, I get that g. So I'm just left with this term. So minus y g of zero and y is zero. So this tells me that I cannot have constant term minus one. So these two things together, they imply that g of t and zero is zero. Okay, so that's one information. And what I want to prove is that the pair GA is unique. Okay, so then what I really want to prove is that A must be the coefficient of Y in G, so that it will look like what we had here. And so I guess this should come by extracting the coefficient of Y in my equation. What does it give? So coefficient of Y here, I get minus g of t and zero, which I know is zero, plus coefficient of y. Here I get nothing. Here this is of the order of y squared, because I told you that there's no constant coefficient. And here I got t times the coefficient of y in g, minus A, which is a series in T, is zero. So with this lengthy and unprepared calculation, I've proved that any solution of this type must satisfy the two following things. G has no constant term in Y, and it's the coefficient of y, which is a power series in T, should be A. And I'm aiming at uniqueness of the pair GA. And I claim I'm nearly there. So with these two things, I can rewrite my equation as G of T and Y is equal, so now I divide again by y, so to ty squared plus t over y g of y or ty squared plus t over y g of ty minus y times the coefficient of y in g. And this thing, this should be my A, as we've proved. Now, of course, you recognize the equation for triangulations of a polygons. And now, from this form, you can conclude that there is a unique power series solution. So there's a subtlety here. We're looking for G as a power series in T and Y. So in other terms, as a power series in T whose coefficients are themselves power series in Y. Okay, power series in T. But here, using this factor T, which you have in every term, you get that there exists a unique power series in T solution. And in fact, it's coefficients. So from here, at first, you will think that they are Laurent polynomials in Y. But because here you're taking G of Y minus YG1 over Y, this has a factor Y, and you get polynomials. But you would be just happy saying that there is a unique solution as a series here in T, and you see that it has polynomial coefficients in Y. But in fact, with the theorem, what suffices is to have coefficients in C, which are power series in Y. OK, so again, this is a bit unprepared, but we've taken this equation. We've convinced ourselves that if you require the pair GA to be in this set of series, then you have a unique solution. Then by Popescu's theorem, this solution must be algebraic, but the solution we know, it is this pair, P of Y, P1, and hence the generating function of triangulations is algebraic. Okay, it's time to stop. I will answer questions if you have some. So what I plan to do the next time is maybe to start with some modern tools to do what? So first, to perform all these calculations. We've taken resultants and discriminants of discriminants. And I want to tell you that on a Maple session, this is just a two-line calculation, especially with this quadratic method. Then we've left one question unsolved, which I want to discuss. For instance, in the case of triangulations, we got a cubic equation for their generating function. And we may guess or wonder or know that the coefficients of this series are nice. That is, they can be expressed in terms of binomial coefficients. How do you guess and prove this? And yeah, so there will be a part where I want to show some Maple tools to construct those sequence of coefficients. And so if you, it's not compulsory. If you happen to be a Maple user and want to come with your laptop with the Maple installed on it, you're welcome to do so. If you're not, I will just show a typical Maple session. I won't spend much time with that. But if you're a Maple user, you may want to install the GFun package, which you can find on Bruno Salvi's webpage. And there's two files to install. Aline, you'll tell me their suffixes. What are the two suffixes that you get when you install a package? Sorry? And what's the other? Sorry? HDB? Okay. So anyway, you'll find on Bruno's webpage two files to install. And so if you have them, that's fine, and you can play with them. And otherwise, that's fine as well. And now if you have questions on this lecture, I'm happy to answer them.